Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at loveisrael.org. That's one word, loveisrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
When we speak about the New Jerusalem, that final state of the kingdom of God, you should be excited. How is that kingdom going to look like? That is to say, what can we discern from the Word of God concerning the New Jerusalem? Well, that's exactly what Revelation chapter 21, that second half of that chapter, deals with. So with that said, take out your Bible and look with me to that place. Revelation chapter 21, and let's begin with verse 9. Now, undoubtedly, when we read this entire second half of chapter 21, the emphasis is on the New Jerusalem, how it looks, what's it composed of. And it's very significant how this revelation to us concerning the New Jerusalem comes. Why do I say that? Look, if you would, to verse 9. And one of the seven angels who carried the seven bowls that were full of what? Well, you recall, they were full of the judgment, and more specifically, they were full of the wrath of God. So one of these angels that carried these seven bowls, he came at this time. And notice what it is. He, speaking about those seven angels that had those seven final plagues, why is one of them being summoned at this time? To teach us a very important truth. Now, many times I speak to someone and we'll be talking about prophetic truth. What is prophetic truth? It is a call to repentance. It is a call to holiness. And one of the ways that God does that is through judgment, through His wrath. And many people say, well, I don't like to think about God's judgment. I believe that's kind of an Old Testament concept, but the God of the New Testament, He's not wrathful. He doesn't judge. That's not Him. Well, let me share with you. Such a perspective is scripturally incorrect. It ignores a wealth of what Yeshua Himself taught. The reason why, when we're going to look at the New Jerusalem and get a picture of how it is put together, what is its appearance, it's very significant that one of these angels come. Why? Here's the truth. To teach us the relationship between God's wrath and the establishment of the kingdom of God. Now, if you watch this teaching each week, you'll recall several months ago, we were in the book of Zechariah, and we talked about how Zechariah reveals a biblical principle. Judgment produces the kingdom. That is to say this, without God's judgment falling, without His wrath being a reality, the kingdom won't be a reality. So it's for this reason why we see that when we begin to announce and find a description of the New Jerusalem, that final state of the kingdom of God, we have one of those seven angels who carried the bowl judgments of God's wrath, him appearing at this time. It says that he spoke unto me, saying, still in verse 1 or verse 9, come and I will show you the bride, who is the wife of the Lamb. So here again, we see something very important. We're talking about the New Jerusalem, and there's a connection, there's an emphasis between the people of the kingdom and the kingdom itself. How it is made, how it's going to be established, there's a connection with the very people of God. Verse 10, and he led me in the spirit to a great mountain, a lofty or high mountain, and he showed me the great city, the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down from the heavens from God, just like we saw earlier last week. And notice what we find in verse 11. And there was to it, that is to that city, the glory of God. Now, that's important because if we want to know one of the chief characteristics of the kingdom of God, it is the glory of God being manifested. Now, don't miss this principle. We've just learned that there's an inherent relationship between the people of God and the kingdom of God. What are we called to glean from that? That we are supposed to be people living today in a way that manifests God's glory. So if that change is not a reality for you, that is, if you are not manifesting the glory of God, then you're not living in His will. You're not submitting to His truth. You are not allowing the Holy Spirit to be manifested through you. You are, in other words, grieving and hindering the Holy Spirit. So when we look here at this scripture, we see one of the foremost characteristics of the kingdom of God is the glory of God. We also find, look again at verse 11, it says, and light shined as how? As a precious stone, a very precious stone, as a stone of jasper. Now, we're going to talk in the next few minutes about several different types of stones. And you're going to find that in your translation, they give names to each of these stones. But here's the truth of the matter. There's some of these stones that we don't know to what type of stone the word, the biblical word, refers to. So what I'm going to do is, if there's a word that we know what stone it is, we're going to announce it. If there's a stone that we don't know the real meaning of that, the type of stone, we're going to leave it in the biblical language. Now, all of these stones, they're not new stones. The stones that we're going to be talking about have an important relationship. They appeared earlier in the scripture, more precisely. They appeared in the law, in the Torah of God. And we're going to see how they were seen in the Old Testament and what we can glean from that in understanding this New Testament revelation. So look again at verse 11. In the middle of the verse, and there was light, a great light that shined like a light of a very precious stone, as a jasper stone, which is clear, clear as crystal. Verse 12. And to it, meaning to the city, the holy city of Jerusalem, the New Jerusalem, there was a great wall. Now, wall, when we're talking about a wall in the Bible, what should come into our mind is security. One of the things that we're going to find out about the New Jerusalem, that holy city, is that there's no reason for fear. There is going to be perfect security. And what we see as we read on in verse 12, there was a wall, a great and high wall. And notice, there was 12 gates to this wall. Now, 12 is an important number. We've seen 12, and sometimes 12 times 1,000, and sometimes we've seen 12,000 times 12. 12 is important. Why? Well, what's a principle that we've already learned? There's a connection, there's a relationship between the people of God and the kingdom of God here, the New Jerusalem. Whenever the number 12 appears in the Bible, the first thing that should come into our mind is the people of God. More precisely, the 12 tribes of Israel. And after that, the 12 disciples, the 12 apostles of Messiah. And we're going to see that these two groups of people, they are connected. Remember, we talked about the 24 elders. So all of this is coming together, 24, obviously, 2 times 12. So once again, verse 12. And to it, meaning to the city, was a great and high wall with 12 gates. And upon the 12 gates, it says, were 12 messengers or angels. And their names were written upon it. And it says, their names were the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. Now let's pause for a moment, because there is very prevalent today within Christianity a theology, in my opinion, from the pit of hell. Why do I say that? Because one of the things that the Antichrist is going to want to do is to destroy Israel. Why? Because he knows that Israel's spiritual condition is related to the purposes and the plans of God. Let me state it another way. If Israel doesn't get right with God, but Israel will. But if it doesn't, or we could say as long as Israel's not right with God, the kingdom won't be established. So Satan, he knows this. So that's why we see that almost in every generation, we see the attempts to destroy the Jewish people. In fact, we see an increase today of anti-Semitism. It's on a rise in great proportions throughout this world. I mean, there are certain places that if a Jewish person went into a country, if he was on a plane and that plane was deterred, they tell him, and this is a fact, it happened not too long ago, a plane was deterred, had to make an emergency landing in an Islamic country. Now, Islamic, I thought that was a religion. And the Bible teaches that true religion keeps oneself unspotted from the world. True religion visits those in need. True religion expresses love. What did they say? Well, the people who were Jewish who was on that plane, they were told by the pilot, you can't leave. If you get off this plane like everyone else and get something to eat and just stretch your legs and such, you are going to be taken away and you're going to be put to death. So that's Islam. And Islam's not really a religion. It is a political movement that masquerades as a religion. So what I want you to see here, when we deal with the kingdom of God, what do we find? The number 12. What's the first thing that should come into our mind? What is stated in verse 12 at the end? It relates. The security, remember those walls and the gates, they all have what? They are connected to the 12 tribes of Israel. Move on to verse 13. And these gates, it says, three were on the east, three were on the north, three were on the south, and three were on the west. Verse 14. And the wall of the city, it had 12 foundations. So God is emphasizing here, when he speaks about the kingdom of God, the important connection between the kingdom, or we could say it this way, the fulfillment of his plan, his purposes, the outcome of that is blessing. What was Israel created to do? To bring the blessings of God into this world. Go back some time to the book of Genesis chapter 12, when God begins to first speak about the children of Israel, and he associates them with blessing. Those who bless you will be blessed. Those who curse you will be cursed. Well, now we're talking about Israel being right with God and therefore the kingdom of God. Now here we see another important truth. Look again at verse 14. And the wall of the city says there was 12 foundations. And upon these 12 foundations, there were 12 names. And these were the apostles of the Lamb. Now, again, we see something. The foundation of Israel is the apostles' teaching. And here's the biblical truth, until Israel accepts the teachings of the apostle, there's not going to be security for Israel. You will see one attempt after another to destroy the Jewish people. We're living in a very unique time. We're living where Psalm 83 is a reality. Why do I say that? Because one of the teachings of Psalm 83 talks about a war, and it says the enemies of Israel are going to be on the borders of Israel. And that's exactly what we see today. And Israel, I live in Israel. My children, one serves in the Israeli army right now. And I can tell you, as great as army as that is, there's no security ultimately with flesh and blood. The security does not come through ultimately through tanks and planes and weapons. Ultimately, that's security, the security that endures forever and ever. That security comes from faith in who? In what the apostles taught about. And who was that? Messiah Yeshua. And that's why, and don't miss the insignificance of this phrase, it talks about the 12 apostles of who? The Lamb. What's Lamb synonymous with? Redemption. The apostles taught about redemption. And what do we learn about redemption? What's the definition? We'll be His people, and He's going to be our God. Look now to verse 15. And in the hand of the one was speaking was a golden, we might say, reed. What do you do with that? Well, it says here for measuring the city and the gates and its walls, verse 16. And coming forth of the city, that is, how the city was laid out might be a better way to translate it. It was laid out as a square, meaning what? It means, or it could be a cube, because it says its length and its width were the same thing. He measured the city with this measuring reed, and it was 12,000, here again the number 12,000 furlongs, or we could say in the ancient language, reis, which is a shorter distance of a mile. So we have, once again, the number 12, as in 12,000. So not just once, not just twice, not just three times, the number 12 appears over and over to emphasize the importance of Israel. It says its length and its width and its height were equal. So everything, its width, its height, its breadth, everything was 12,000. That's why I say it was a square, but when you look at it, it becomes, because of its height, it becomes a cube. And what do we understand about that? We'll keep reading, because we find at the end, look if you would to verse 17. And he measured the walls, and it was 144, what does it say? Amot, or cubits. Not to be confused with a cube. A cubic was a measuring. So we find 144, look again, verse 18, 144 cubits. And this is the measuring of a man. Now, there's two ways to understand this last part of verse 17. It says it was the measuring of a man, and we could see it trying to tell us it was literally an angel, because biblically speaking, we see that sometimes when a man is mentioned, it's really an angel. And sometimes when he refers to an angel, he appears as a man. So that's one interpretation. There's another kind of a mystical one. And what is that? It tells us that in the kingdom of God, the perspective of human beings are going to have the same perspective of angels. We're going to see things from a heavenly perspective. So that's one interpretation. Look at verse 18. The construction of the walls, and now we're speaking of the walls, they were jasper stone. And it says the city, it was a fine gold likened to glass, pure glass, verse 19. And the foundations of the wall of the cities, they were adorned with every type of desirable stone. The first foundation was jasper. Now we're coming into the point where we have these stones. And if you know the Torah well, that is, if you know what is said, for example, in the second book of the Torah, that is the book of Exodus, this is going to be familiar, these stones, to you. Why do I say that? Well, keep reading. Verse 19, it says, and the foundations of the wall of the city, they were adorned with every type of desirable stone. The first foundation was jasper. The second was sapphire, or sapphire in English. The third was, and it's the term cheval. Now, we don't know with assurance what type of stone that is. The fourth one was berechet, which is, they believe, emerald of today. The fifth was yahalom, which is diamond. The sixth was odem. And here again, probably a reddish type of stone, because the word odem comes from the Hebrew word for red. We keep reading. The seventh one was Tarshish, that type of stone. The eighth was Shoham. And the ninth was Pitda. The tenth was Nofech. The 11th one was Leshem. And the 12th one was Achlama. So what's important about this? Here's the key. All of these stones, whatever the true meaning of these words are, what type of stones we're referring to, we don't know in its entirety, But we know that these stones were where? They were on the breastplate of the high priest. And these stones, here's the key. These stones, there were 12 of them. Why? Because each stone was connected to one of the 12 tribes of Israel. So here's what I want you to see. A few minutes ago, I talked about an improper theology. What's that improper theology? Replacement theology. And the reason why I said it's from the pit of hell is because it furthers the purposes and the will and the objective of Satan. Because when we talk about the purposes and the plans and the objective of God, at the very foundation is Israel. Now, let me tell you another important truth. Don't miss the significance that the foundation of the walls were the teachings of the apostles of Messiah. What is that to help us glean from? Here's the key. We're supposed to support Israel. That is, believers, those who have faith in Jesus Christ, should be strong supporters of Israel and the Jewish people. That's why it says the foundation of those walls were the apostles' teaching. Now, let me give you another example. Yesterday, I was speaking to another group, and we were dealing with Luke chapter 7. And there we talk about this centurion. And what is that centurion known for? He has a great faith. What type of faith? It says that Yeshua was so shocked. He was amazed. In other words, we could say he was impressed with the centurion's faith. And what was he known for? Well, you look sometime of Luke chapter 7 and verse 5. What does it say about the centurion? Says that he loves the Jewish people. And he built, see, if you love, you're going to respond. And he built a synagogue for the people where? In Capernaum. Let me tell you kind of a funny but also sad story. Now, I used to work with groups coming to Israel and take them around. And every group, we would go to the city called Capernaum or Capernaum. This is the headquarters for Yeshua's ministry. And there you go there, one of the main things you visit is a synagogue. And that synagogue is a beautiful limestone of today. But if you look at the foundations of the original synagogue, it was basalt stone. It's a different color. It's a black or a dark brown stone. And here's the key. I always ask people, who built this synagogue? And sometimes a guy will want to be cute and he'll say, some Jewish guy. I say, no, it wasn't a Jewish guy. It was a Gentile who built the synagogue, the centurion who had great faith. So if you want to have great faith, one that impresses God, one that's pleasing to Messiah, then you're going to be someone who supports Israel, who is concerned about the spiritual condition of the Jewish people. Well, let's move on. Look now, if you would, to verse 21. It says, and the 12 gates, it says that they were 12 pearls. Each gate was a pearl, one pearl in and of itself. And the streets of the city was a fine gold. It was clear like glass. Verse 22, and here's something important. Verse 22, and there was no temple. He says, I did not see a temple in her, meaning in the New Jerusalem. Why? Why no temple? Well, one of the key elements of the temple is the altar. There's going to be no sin, so there's no longer any need for sacrifice. Yeshua, he paid the price fully for all sin. So in the New Jerusalem, a state of perfection, eternal perfection, there's going to be no temple. Notice what he says. Look again at verse 22. For I saw no temple in it. Why? Here's the reason. For the Lord God of hosts, he is the temple, he and the Lamb. Verse 23. And the city, it did not have any light of the sun, nor did the moon shine. Why? What did we learn is the main characteristic of the New Jerusalem? Glory. The glory of God. What's going to be the source of illumination? The glory of God. That's why he says, I did not see, he says, the sun or the moonshine, for the glory of God illuminated the city. But the lamp, that is the source of that light, was who? It says at the end of verse 23, the Lamb, verse 24. and the nations who were saved, they walked in the light of its light, and the kings of the earth, they brought their glory and their splendor to it, meaning everything that made them great, they saw that it had nothing to do with this world, but it was all the real greatness led into the kingdom of God, meaning they wanted to use their life for the exaltation of the character, the likeness, the character of the kingdom of God. Look on to verse 25. And the gates all day, every day, they were not closed. We already learned there's no night in that city, so they were open all the time. Why? Perfect security, no threat. And they would bring into it the glory of the nations and their splendor, verse 27. But those who were unclean, they could not come into it, neither those who did abominable things, those who are lying. For those who are not written, where? In the book of life of the Lamb. So the only way, and this is one of the most important truths in all the Scripture, the only way one can enter into the New Jerusalem is if their name is written in the Lamb's book of life. Why Lamb? Lamb is synonymous with redemption. Unless you have experienced and claimed and accepted the blood of the Lamb, you are not going to be in that glorious kingdom, that kingdom of perfect security, that kingdom where there's no more tears, no more sorrow, no more death, no more sin. My hope and my prayer is that you have invited Yeshua into your life. Well, until next week, when we press on into Revelation chapter 22, may God richly bless you.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of loveisrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, loveisrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with Him. Shalom from Israel.